guys who got a lot of cysts in certain spots. So they'd be like hard, sort of puffy.
Roy's there. Now Roy's going to do the same thing that you were doing to Roy when he was on the other side. Now you're going to see how it fits. Yeah. Okay, so we can, different ways, like ground yourself. Can everyone see okay? You guys can kind of see? Okay. Just ground yourself. Breathe easy. I breathe nice and easy. Okay. Good girl. You're going to have a massage today? Mika? Mika's going to have a massage, a little bit of massage demo, right? Okay. Okay, so some opening strokes would be, for example, effleurage. They always say opening the massage, starting the massage. And this always feels good, I think, when you're first getting your massage going and you're just kind of getting into it. So you can do a few strokes down the side. If she was right on her side laying flat, you can totally access the side a lot easier too. But right now she's a little curved up, right? Okay. And the back, and remember, I am right on her back, but I'm over her spine. But if you notice where my hand is, it's raised up over the spine, like it's very gentle on the spine. And she has more pressure on either side of the spine, okay? And then, Roy, please don't get jealous. We're going to do the same sort of effleurage. So effleurage is like contact with the entire hand. And actually, while we're here, I'm going to show you working with different parts of the hand. So why don't we do that? So we said the heel of the hand was one. Okay, so heel of the hand might work in different areas. Like I obviously would not do a heel in the stomach, right? It's like someone kicking you in the stomach. And you think of the size of the muscles, right? So I honestly don't work too much just with the heel of my hand. A heel might work well, think where you would like the heel. The pectorals, deep muscles, right? A nice deep area to work. So the heel could work there because it's partly used in the kneading anyway. So this way it's just the heel. Using the palm. So one of the techniques is curved hand compression, CHC, or palm compression, PC. You'll see some short forms. So curved hand works well on an area that's curved. So right here, you can warm up an area by curving, curved palm, and you might go, good girl. Up and down like that, whereas just palm compression is would be flatter, like that. And we're, you know, you're never gonna press hard on the stomach, but I don't use the flat one too much. I tend to use more curved, and again, you want to mold your hands around the dog. So as you're going around the different areas, you notice my hands kind of following the whole thing. I'm taking advantage of going here by scooping under, touching there. Getting into this part here, that's the tendon, like a tendon right there. You know right there you're just going to be more gentle because you can just feel it. It's a more gentle area. Okay. And going to the front. I'm going to go back to the head after, but here's some, I don't know if you can see it, but kneading. Kind of like you're digging in and you're sort of pulling out.
So it's for bigger muscles, the harder.
You would do it on a bigger area where you can grab, like think where you can, like here you can grab, right? Like there on your butt you can grab. So think of the equivalent here you can grab. Okay, so that'd be one idea, like that. I don't know if this is actually a technique that I'm doing or just something that I do. I know it's some sort of technique.
Is that kneading? Would that be kneading?
It's kind of like kneading, isn't it? That's what I think, yeah.
That's what I would say.
Yeah, it's a little different. I think they actually love it around here. And that's when you start working into another area. So you're suddenly working here, you come down, but then you decide, oh, I'm just going to go up. And then suddenly, because I know what that kind of feels like, it's like down. Sometimes someone's lifting me up. Like, look, I'm having an herbalescence moment, right? Like that's kind of the feeling. So, yeah, so again, kneading in deep areas, like that. Another technique that you can use for a deep, and you can alternate it. So You can actually work with one hand. You can work both hands together. The knee is at the same time. You can do one and then the other. One and then the other. It gives it kind of like a rhythm. Yeah, like a rhythm like that. So another technique is scooping. So scooping, kind of trying to like lean forward enough to show it, but it's like you're sort of digging in and then doing a scoop. Digging in and doing a scoop. I'd say that works well in this area.
Sure. How's that different from kneading?
I'm trying to twist it. It's not easy because there's not a lot of space either. Kneading is more like straight. So right now I'm just, you see? Kneading straight, scooping, you're actually kind of doing a bit of a twist at the end, almost like you're scoop, kind of like that.
So scoop is backwards, not forward, or can it be both?
I guess it can be both. Yeah. I think it's mostly this way, but I think it could be probably this way as well.
Like the side of the hand?
Yeah, I would say it's usually this way. Scooping is not a technique I use a lot either. I use it, but not a lot. I like kneading more, probably for myself, I guess. Okay. And then there's a technique called, actually let's do that here. So you can also knead in a nice meaty area here. So you've worked it with some palm, curved palm compression. For example, you warmed it up. You might go around the shoulder. A lot of what you do in the fore limb, you're going to do in the hind limb if you kind of noticed and you read like the squeezing of the paws, this warm up the area, whatever. You want to go around the point of shoulder. So around the shoulder, and then you're kind of going around the hip as well, there's the bone here. So you just kind of find the spot here, and you can kind of work the area like that. You can work actually all the way around. And you're going to see, you know that one muscle is about here, like right here I can feel a separation. I know there's something here. Right here is a nice little groove. So get familiar with that groove in your dog. Just while I'm here, I'm just jumping topics, but I don't want to miss it. It feels, look, that was a nice yawn. Good girl, good girl. Okay, so, and there's one on the other side as well. There'll be two of those grooves as well. So that would be called, like a form of stripping, I guess. Stripping with one finger, stripping with both. Good girl. Yeah, good girl. Okay, so back to kind of kneading. This is a good area for it because it's meaty. And then you always make sure that you're supporting. So if I'm pressing down here, I'm supporting the limb here. I'm not just letting the limb fly in the air or just pushing down against it. Good girl. You're actually quite good. And finding this nice little interesting spot here.
The inside of the stifle there?
Yeah, finding this. Like the gracilis is there and there's a whole bunch of muscles there that... In humans, too, you get pulled back there, right? So, nice. Nice, you're such a good girl. Okay, so now if we go back here, I showed you a bit of stripping here, Roy. I think if you just take the one finger or the thumb, depending on the size of the head, for me it works easier, honestly, with my finger, and you do a nice deliberate line. And what I was saying to someone here is you want to move this hand back here. Well, you're not going to, hi, you're looking at me with your beautiful brown eyes. Roy, don't be jealous. So you're taking this hand back. How are you going to get back there? You can't lift it. You have to keep the continuous flow here. So that's where you have this other hand here, and it should feel natural. So you can work in a motion. This hand's going back. This one's going here. Is he jealous? Or is he okay?
He's just sniffing. Okay, great.
Yeah, so that's where I want to go back here. I'm going to move this hand up to the front and go here. So you're not leaving the dog. And one flows just into the other. It's like this area flowing into here, it's flowing into here. So you can work in areas individually, but you can also just give them a nice all-over massage. So with a finger again. Roy, look, you won't sit here, so I had no choice. Okay, like that. Tapping. So tap. Yeah. tapping apparently stimulates the activity in the senses up here. You can do tapping with a few fingers. You have to actually be very calm to tap, and it takes some practice because it's very easy that your fingers, they lose control and they can't keep, do you know what I mean? Like you don't have the control of your fingers to do such a steady motion, so it's actually not the easiest technique to do smoothly. The ridge here, nice circles behind here, always kind of appreciated, for example. And notice I'm actually doing more than circling. I'm actually kind of, it's almost like taking a fork, two forks, and with your spaghetti and doing this, churning. Oh, you know when you do your gardening, that's yes. The soil. I'm kind of doing something like that there. Yeah. Is that good? That's
30 good. On.
Good. Okay, yeah. And that's pretty good because we're just doing technique here. So now for this area. So you can do like nice little circles. I like to alternate. I mean, I like to do nice long strokes on a dog's face. If a dog has long fur like a poodle, my sister always tells me, make sure you don't brush the hair into their eyes. Okay? Temporal lobes. This area here always feels good. So you can kind of tap a little here. You can do nice like soothing strokes. I think the circles honestly probably feel the best. I don't massage inside a dog's mouth. That I haven't done. You could, but I probably wouldn't recommend it until you actually know the dog as well. So again, little circles. You can, the head's getting more and more relaxed. See? So now how to do ears. I'm actually totally bent over, so I'm just trying to do my best. But you can hold the head here. You notice how I have my hands on the jaw. So literally, like around the flue. Nice long strokes. Don't leave the hand, don't leave the contact. Good girl. Down into the neck. Can we do that again? Can we do that again? Yeah. Oh, that's
good. She loves the treatment.
Yeah. Moving into the ear. So different things that you do with ears. Can do continuous. You can actually, I like to do this, especially if the dog's got a meteor type of a head, where you're literally going around the base of the ear on the outside, and the head's being kind of massaged a little bit. The inside of the ear is apparently feels really good, right? So I guess you have to be really delicate with the inside, and then you're losing some contact. Kind of hard to. You can actually massage a little bit the inside. Is that okay?
Nice thing about the inner part of the ear is unlike us where we have ear canals that go straight in, dogs are shaped like an L, so you have no risk of damaging the eardrum by accident at any point.
That's good. Okay, so now what I'm doing is just something different. I just happened to have my hands in a cross position. I thought, what a perfect spot to manipulate a little bit the pectorals, and I'm actually getting his shoulders, and I'm just doing kind of this, and it's kind of like kneading. How am I going to come across? I'm going to do this. I'm not going to lose the contact, right? I'm not going to just suddenly go like this and go, okay, right? Just take advantage.
I'm so confused.
When I did that?
Yeah.
Did you see how right away, you take it off? They know something's wrong. Even though I'm blabbing, she knows that something's happening. It feels good. And if I lay my hands down, so that would be a really slow stroke, a faster one, like this. And they were talking about towards the heart and fast. I would say this would be faster and towards the heart, against the nap. It's supposed to energize, so let's say you want to take them on a hike. Okay, versus slow and with the grain. What, direct pressure? I haven't really done too much direct pressure, right? So we can do some of that. Okay, so an area that might work. Oh, actually I want to just go over the leg while it's out. So you might warm it up by doing some palm compression. You might get in between the fibers by doing cross-fiber friction. And the other word, it sounds so similar. There's a zigzag, there's cross-fiber. You can do circles, but they all kind of do the same thing. Like you can actually kind of do this, and you're going across the fibers like that. But you can do the curved hand compression down the leg. And like we were saying, some dogs like the top of the paw, some don't like it. So if you know that, I know this dog doesn't like top of paw, she likes bottom of paw, I'm going to not try to push the top of paw with her. I'm just going to leave it. But this area is a great area too. And you can try to get like a little bit of a gentle squeeze. She doesn't want to really give me her toes, so I'm not going to push it, like I said. So then I go back to an area that she likes. You just did something that she's not thrilled with because you touched her feet. So now I'm going to go back to an area that she likes, maybe before I move on. Okay, now before I go on to DP, why don't we do some raking, since it just falls into the right spot. You have ribs, you have the intercostals. So this feels good. You can alternate. You can do both at once if you feel like it. You're actually literally doing both at once. Okay, it's all good. So you can also do things like circles. So let's say you want to do three light circles, and then you're going to go maybe three medium circles, and then maybe you're going to zone in and go three smaller circles, and you notice I have more pressure, right? So you might go into an area lighter, bigger, right? Lighter and bigger, then go medium, a little heavier, and then this is the spot I wanted to zone in on, let's say. Right here, I kind of feel like, yeah, I think I need to go in that spot. So that's how I kind of warmed up into it, right? And try to go like a little slower. Yeah, and then, yeah. Okay. Yeah, oh, do you like that? Do you like that or do you not like that? You're kind of thinking about it. Sometimes they think about it and then they decide, I think I like that, right? You might get the space that says I'm thinking about it. Just trying something different. So like skin roll works well. Is actually good, I mean, for all dogs, but for older dogs, let's say, because sometimes older dogs tend to be dehydrated or their circulation isn't as good. So you can actually just grab skin, right? You can do it rhythmically like this. So what I'm going to do now is, let's say, all right, why don't I just kind of work up, and I'm kind of grabbing skin and loosening up the layers and the fibers. As I'm moving up, I'm not putting pressure on the spine, as you can see. And I'm going to work it all up to an area that she likes. So I have bad body mechanics right now, because as you can see, I'm leaning too far over and I can up and feel it on my neck. But she's way out there, so good girl. Yeah, skin roll. Working with fingers. Fingers, working with the palm, working with the hands, working with the back of the hands, just working direct pressure. So direct pressure works in a bunch of areas. One might be to strip the legs, as they say, because you feel all these different things. You've got high radius and ulna. And there's all sorts of tendons and ligaments and all sorts of things here, right? So a good thing to do is warm it up with a curved hand compression. It's easier on the meatier dog too. The smaller the dog, the harder this technique obviously gets. But then, yeah, no paw. Okay, I should have known that, right? And then you actually want to work down by stripping. So she's obviously sensitive about her paw. So what I'm going to do is just show it to you here more. So you might use your thumb, you can use your thumb, you can use a finger, you can use a thumb and a finger, go on either side, right? Is that okay though? Would you say that's okay or no? And never put pressure on, obviously, an area like the kneecap right there, or a lot of pressure on the elbow. So direct pressure, you can use it. I'm going to work on another area soon, but you can use it around as well. It works well when you have points of tension, I would say. Which actually feels like really loose back here. Pretty good.
Yeah, it's
quite nice actually. So I'm kind of kneading. So we're going to kind of get into some of the muscles where the direct pressure, it's kind of like stripping direct pressure, right? This one? I'm not holding it steady. I'm moving it at the same time, but she's getting a little more pressure. In this area here, once you've warmed it up, what works well here too is the cross fiber type techniques. So this is the glutes right now. I like to kind of work them like this and really knead them because they're meaty and and most dogs seem to just love it. And it works very well when you have the dog, like Sassy yesterday was sitting, and you can actually grab like right underneath like this as well. But if you get in there in a good way, you like that? Yeah, you like that, I think. The dogs actually really like it. Good girl. Is good? It's good, right? It feels good. Okay. So if it didn't feel good by now, she'd be telling me, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, good. So this area too around the tail, feel on your dog when you go back. It's a nice little groove, and you can actually get in quite deep. So here's an area where you can actually use some direct pressure. You can go like right in like that. So you can actually hold it or you can just kind of strip it. She's posing now for the thing. Techniques for the tail. I like to actually I had to finish something else, but no, I'll go to the tail now. I like to just kind of start going into the tail, working. You can actually do the curved hand. You can actually gently squeeze the tail. And remember they said to keep it on the same plane. It's kind of what I've read, like yank the tail up to squeeze it. Just try to keep it on the sort of level plane. And you're kind of safe. Or follow the shape of the tail is nice too. And they like it like off the tail. And I like doing this. I like really getting in there. Like you can actually get. So if a dog is really sensitive, and you said how old is she again? At least 10? Yeah. So yeah, she's actually taking this quite well. If you have a dog that doesn't want to get on the other side, we're saying that some dogs almost never want to get on the other side. Sometimes the best you can do is work the front limb, because you want to do the other side, work the side, get as much of the second leg as you can, and then you can scoop your hand underneath and just work the muscles this way. You can actually still get some of that. And sometimes the reason that they never give you that side is because that's a side that actually bothers them and they want less contact there. So you'll learn that too.
This Kaylee earlier, the reason she didn't give me the other side was because the other hip was sore and she didn't want to sit on it. So
Yeah. So you'll see that. Have you felt this?
She's got a fatty lump.
Yeah.
And it used to be a massive radius of inflammation around it, so it is a lot better.
Yeah,
and it's getting there, but it's
okay.
Slow.
Okay, so yeah, so it was right there. You can actually, do you want to feel actually what it feels like? So you know, you can touch it right there.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So right away, if you feel something like that on a dog, you should be going, "Oh, what is that?" Right? Because that one's an obvious one. Where? What is that? I thought it was fatty.
Yeah, it's a fatty. I want to come up for sure. And you can kind of like get an idea of the inflammation around it in some spots.
It's kind of hard, but it moves.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, everyone's touching my fatty lump.
One of them.
Okay.
Those moxa sticks will actually melt the fatty lump, but you have to know it's a fatty lump first.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's good to know.
She used to have a really large one on her side, and I've moxed that. It's only a very faint bump.
Okay.
My dog's got one that's big. Oh, wow. The flank.
So what I want to do right now is just feel where her spine is. It's actually on some dogs.
She's a little tricky. You can feel it in the.
It feels like it's moved. Yeah. It's like, but you know it has to follow the tail, so you know it's obviously somewhere around here. You think it's here, but it's not. It's way over here. I'm trying to find the spine, which is not okay. That's the shoulders. That's the withers area right there in between the soft area, the shoulder blades, the scapula is coming up. The withers are there. Spine. So direct pressure, you can do. Oh, there it is. Perfect. Okay.
Feel anything in
mid spine? I'm trying to get right to the spine actually. I find this part's tricky. Hold on. Okay, that's the spine right there. Hold on. Oh, twitching.
Yeah.
Yeah, right here. Yeah, so right here it twitches a little bit.
Yeah.
Not now though. It was more when I was approaching it.
Yeah, and it's only like a little spot.
Yeah.
Where it's at.
Like right
so
there.
So far, anyway.
So I don't want to go too hard on her because she's kind of older as well. But direct pressure, you can literally go. On Roy, you can do it a lot easier to practice, but space it out with the spine either way and leave the fingers there. And you might have one hand on the dog as you're doing it. Another thing is you can like strip with the thumb and the finger on either side of the spine and just take that nice and slow like that, and then you can actually work up with the direct pressure too, so you can do that technique all the way up as well to about here. That's usually where they like it. And then I would give them something nice on the head, around the head, around the neck, because they were good and they sat for the spine work. Okay, now there's another technique, probably we'll just talk about it, maybe because it'll take a bit longer, I'll talk about it after, but did I miss an obvious one? Tapotement, let's say? Yeah. So tapotement, like your hand is kind of like a teepee, like an A, and you're creating, she keeps way out of my
grace. She loves the treatment.
Oh yeah?
She could stay on that table all day long. As soon as I say treatment, she goes straight to her dog bed and lies down and waits patiently.
Oh, okay, so she knows. Okay, I get it, so she knows.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or if she sees the moxa come out, she'll go straight to her dog bed.
She knows.
Yeah.
And then vibration.
Oh, yeah, vibration, yeah. And I kind of did jostling, but we can do that again. So that's, I was kind of like alternating. Jostling.